Blackstone Publishing presents A Native's Return, 1945 to 1988, by William L. Shirer. This book is read by Grover Gardner. Preface. This is the third and last volume recounting one man's journey through the 20th century, a time that saw more changes on the planet than in the previous 1900 years. It saw more violence, too, more bloodshed, bigger, more devastating wars. There were, to be sure, periods of peace and growing prosperity for many, especially in the USA. Science and invention exploded, utterly transforming the way we lived and altering our conception of our origins and our place in the universe. Youngsters today say they simply cannot imagine what life was like, say, back in 1904 when I was born, when people got about in horse and buggies, before the automobile, the telephone, electric lighting and power, and central heating came into general use, before there were airplanes, movies, radio and television, oil burners, electric refrigerators, air conditioners, gasoline-driven tractors, paved roads, garages, filling stations, traffic lights, parking lots, shopping centers, airports, income taxes, social welfare, women's suffrage, computers, VCRs, jet engines, radar, moon landings, napalm bombs, nuclear bombs, space rockets, spaceships, space stations, lasers, and much else that has become commonplace today. My father, who had a college and law school education and was a liberal, tolerant man, not an old fogey at all and only 42 when he died, thought motor cars, of which there were only a few thousand in the whole land, were a menace and should be barred from the city streets and the country roads because they endangered pedestrians and frightened horses. He also took a dim view of airplanes, of which there were only a handful, all tiny biplanes, in the whole country. The idea of travel by air, especially across continents and oceans at close to the speed of sound or beyond it, he would have dismissed as a pipe dream. If God had intended us to fly, he told me after we saw our first planes in a primitive demonstration of a dozen sputtering little biplanes over Grand Park in Chicago on September 27, 1910, he would have given us wings. Let's leave flying to the birds. Whether all these ingenious mechanical inventions and their fantastic developments during the 20th century have improved the quality of life and given it more depth and meaning, I doubt. They have certainly liberated men, and especially women, from much drudgery, opened horizons not dreamed of at the turn of the century, and speeded up living to such a frantic pace that I often want to get off the merry-go-round and catch my breath and regain my senses. All these developments have also improved the standard of living of most people immensely. Though tens of millions on Earth still hunger and remain homeless, a sizable and disgraceful number in the affluent USA. Most of us, at least in the West, are much better off materially than when I was born. But are we better educated, happier, wiser? For most of the first 20 years of my adult life, I worked abroad, and the previous two volumes of these memoirs have dealt largely with the world beyond our shores, principally Europe. This book has to do with a coming home, and what, after so long an absence, it was like to live and work in America during the nearly half a century since the end of the Second World War. Luck or fate or God or whatever it is that determines the extent of our lives allowed me to live through most of this tumultuous 20th century and through a sizable chunk of our country's existence. In fact, as James Reston reminded me recently, our work as reporters and commentators on our times, stretching as it has over a half century or more, has covered 1/4 of the life of the Republic, in my own case, 64 of its 200 years. For me, it has been a long journey, full of ups and downs, as with most lives, but wonderful and exciting and perplexing and troubling almost all the way. Book 1. A Coming Home, 1945. Chapter 1. Twice before, in 1940 and 1944, I had got back from the war in time for Christmas. And now, as the holiday approached in 1945, I was coming home for the third time. For good, I hoped. The war was over. Germany, which had started it on the first day of September 1939, had surrendered unconditionally on May 7th. Japan had given up on August 14th. I would never forget those first August days when the long war ended. The news was almost too tremendous to grasp. How could you be prepared for the news that burst upon us on Monday, August 6th? That day we had dropped an atomic bomb on Hiroshima, a large city in Japan of which I had not previously heard, just as I had never heard before of an atom bomb. The force from which the sun draws its awesome power had for the first time ever been unleashed by us to slaughter human beings and wipe out their cities. President Truman had taken to the air to tell us about it. The single bomb over Hiroshima, he said, had the explosive force of 20,000 tons of TNT. The extent of the damage it had caused, the War Department declared, was not yet known. An impenetrable cloud of dust and smoke reaching up to the heavens had masked the target area from U.S. reconnaissance planes. But a bomb of such terrifying force was bound to have caused appalling loss of human life and property. The additional destructiveness of radioactive fallout was not mentioned. Only a handful of insiders, the little band of American scientific geniuses who in great secrecy had built the bomb in the sands of New Mexico, knew that radioactive fallout might in the end be the most frightful consequence of all. This would dawn on the rest of us later. What concerned us at the time was not so much the capacity of the bomb for unbelievable destruction. No one thought of it, as we later would, as threatening to blow up the planet, but whether the bomb would terrify the Japanese into surrendering and ending the war. When that occurred after we had dropped a second bomb, this time on Nagasaki, everyone on the globe, I think, friend, enemy, or neutral, was immensely relieved that the war was over, that the mass killing and the terrible destruction would cease. We would have blessed peace on what was left of a stricken world. Somehow we felt, though, that the planet would never be the same again. The explosion of the two American atom bombs over Japan had ended one age for mankind. We stood suddenly, apprehensive and unprepared, at the dawn of a new one. In its editorial that morning, I noted, the New York Times posed the problem and asked the crucial question. A revolution in science and a revolution in warfare have occurred on the same day. Civilization and humanity can now survive only if there is a revolution in mankind's political thinking. But can mankind grow up quickly enough to win the race between civilization and disaster? It was a question that would hang over the rest of my life like a dark, threatening cloud and cast its shadow over this book from the first page to the last. A half century later, there is still no answer and no prospect of one. The mad race is still on, and no one can yet be sure how it will end and how soon. That spring, CBS had sent me out to San Francisco to cover the founding of the United Nations. I had asked to be sent back to Europe to report on what would certainly be our final triumph over Nazi Germany. I had spent so much of my life writing and broadcasting about that country, had been in Berlin when World War II was launched 6 years before, and had observed at first hand Germany's amazing early triumphs in Poland and in the West, that I very much wanted to be in on its defeat, which had seemed so improbable in the first.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.